Actually, no, that first one is both.
I Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome, all of you, to First Parish Church Congregational. We're an open and affirming member of the United Church of Christ, and that means that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are always welcome here. As you can hear from perfectly timed practice bagpipes, some of you might be able to hear happening outside, we do have a bagpipe alert today. During the anthem, which will take place a little bit later in the service, there will be bagpipes playing, and they're going to be great and beautiful. They're also kind of loud, so don't be too surprised if all of a sudden from behind you a very loud noise erupts. It's just a joyful noise. Another exciting thing that's happening today that starts with a B is that we have a baptism. We actually have two baptisms taking place today. And so we celebrate having the Rasmussens and the Parazellis here today for that. It's our first baptism since before COVID, and I think that's a wonderful thing to celebrate. Along with all of that, we're also, you know, worshiping God and enjoying our company with one another. So if that wasn't enough to get you out of bed today, we've got a couple of other extra things happening. So thank you all so much for worshiping. I'm Pastor Dan Hollis. Our senior pastor, Eric Dupuy, is still on vacation this week. So you're stuck with me again. Sorry. If you need to leave, the exits are there and there. But with that spirit of joy and the spirit of worship on our hearts, let us be together. Let us seek God in community with one another together today. I invite you to join me in a spirit of prayer. Oh God, you call us to embrace both you and the children of this world with unconditional love. Give us grace to discern what your love asks of us, that we may serve you with an undivided heart. Help us to fill all creation with your love, so that by living with your spirit on our sleeves, and in our actions, we may become one living body, your presence here on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite Reed and Allie to bring their families forward. Gesundheit. They were bringing children to Jesus that Jesus might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them. But when Jesus saw it, Jesus was indignant and said to them, "Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the realm of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the realm of God like a child shall not enter it." And Jesus took them in his arms and blessed them, laying his hands upon them. The sacrament of baptism is an outward and visible sign of the grace of God. Inasmuch as the promise of the gospel is not only to us, but to our children, baptism with water and the Holy Spirit is the mark of their acceptance into the care of Christ's church, the sign and seal of their participation in God's forgiveness, and the beginning of their growth into full Christian faith and discipleship. This is the water of baptism. Out of this water, we rise with new life, forgiven of sin and one in Christ, members of Christ's body. Kristen, Henry, Shannon, and Jordan, do you desire to have your children baptized into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? If so, please say, we do. Will you encourage these children to renounce the powers of evil and to receive the freedom of new life in Christ? If so, please say, we will with the help of God. Will you teach these children that they may be led to profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? If so, please say, we will with the help of God. Do you promise, by the grace of God, to be Christ's disciples, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and word of Jesus Christ as best you are able? If so, please say, we do with the help of God. Do you promise, according to the grace given you, to grow with these children in the Christian faith, to help these children to be faithful members of the Church of Jesus Christ by celebrating Christ's presence, by furthering Christ's mission in all the world, and by offering the nurture of the Christian church so that they may affirm their baptism? If so, please say, we do with the help of God. On behalf of Christians everywhere, I invite the congregation to join together in answering this call. Jesus Christ calls us to make disciples of all nations and to offer them the gift of grace in baptism. Do you, who witness and celebrate this sacrament, promise your love, support, and care to the ones about to be baptized as they live and grow in Christ? If so, please say, we promise our love, support, and care. We promise our love, support, and care. Bless by your Holy Spirit, gracious God, this water. By your Holy Spirit, save those who confess the name of Jesus Christ, that sin may have no power over them. Create new life in the ones baptized this day, that they may rise in Christ. Glory to you, eternal God, the one who was and is and shall always be, world without end. Amen. So, who'd like to go first? I'm about to get up in your business, so I wanted to put a mask on. Come forward, Allie. You want to touch the water? Test it. Feel good? Allie, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Thank you. Step back. All right, here comes Reed. Hey, buddy. Look at this. Water. Check that out. Look at that. Yeah. There it is. That's what I'm talking about. Reed Francis, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray for the ones baptized today.
Gracious God, you have filled the world with joy by giving us the gift of Jesus. Bless these newly baptized people. May they be filled with joy. May they never be ashamed to confess a personal faith in you. The Holy Spirit be upon you, Allie and Reed, child of God, disciple of Christ, member of the church. And the crowd goes wild. Gracious God, bless the parents of these children. May they always show their gratitude for the life you have given by loving and caring for Allie and Reed. And bless these, your faithful people. Unite them in the peace of Christ and the company of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen. And before you go, we have some parting gifts for you.
Home. rest is to sing God's praise. Then when we'd first begun, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see.
Will you join me in prayer? Loving God, we come before you today with a great many sounds on our hearts. We come before you with the sound of bagpipes, the sound of singing, the sound of prayers, and the beautiful sounds of babies. God, we thank you for the beauty that you reveal in this world, not just by sight, but by sound, and by touch, and by taste, by all the ways that you communicate the beauty of this creation to us. We come before you with thanks that words cannot do justice. And we come before you with prayers on our hearts, prayers of joy and celebration, prayers of thanksgiving, prayers of sadness and grief, loss, prayers of uncertainty, of fear, of hope, and yes, even prayers of anger. God, this day we give thanks for Reed and Allie baptized today, and we pray for all of those that you welcome into the faith and family of Jesus Christ. May every church that they walk into from this day to the end of days be as loving and welcoming as this one, as loving and as welcoming as you want us all to be to all of your children. We continue to pray for the loved ones of Beverly Fenn, Martha King's mother, who passed recently. And we pray for all of those that we know and that we don't know who are facing surgery and recovery. We think particularly of Stan and Rich. We ask God for clarity and guidance for Sean. And God, we lift up our hearts for the Prosser family who bid Emmett goodbye this morning at sunrise. May he rest well in your loving arms. And God, we lift up before you the names or the situations that are closest to our hearts this day, now, whether we lift them aloud or we lift them in the silences of our hearts, knowing that you hear us. All that we can say and all that we can't, God, we lift up to you, knowing that you hear us, knowing that you understand us, and knowing that you love us. We continue to pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's reading is from Ephesians 1, 3 through 14, Spiritual Blessings in Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made us known to the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we have obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of the truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance toward redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory. The word of the Lord.
We had the privilege of celebrating a baptism today, two baptisms, the first baptisms we've performed since before the pandemic, which is such a wonderful milestone. I'm grateful that we could experience such a sacrament together, and it was made all the more special by the fact that it was a doubleheader, so to speak. And I think it's very special that Allie and Reed are cousins and were able to share this moment together as a family. Now, whether or not baptism includes, like it did today, family members related by blood, all baptisms are a family affair. Baptism is not just a special event in the life of one family. It's also a recognition that the one being baptized is a member of a family much bigger than that. I want to share with you one of my favorite stories about a baptism. I don't know if it's a true story, it probably isn't, but I love it all the same. Two American men were touring Europe and were scheduled to arrive in France Sunday afternoon. However, they arrived several hours early and didn't have anything to do on Sunday morning while everything was closed. "Well," says one to the other, pointing to a nearby cathedral, "why don't we check out the service at that fancy old church?" "Sure," replies his friend, "but we don't know how the French worship, and we can't speak French." The first guy thinks of a solution. "We'll pick someone in front of us, and whatever he does, we do." His friend agrees. They enter the church, sit close to the front, and choose a guy to mimic. 15 minutes pass, and their plan is working well. 30 minutes, no issues. By the time 45 minutes pass, they've gotten used to the routine. Then, while everyone is seated, the priest says something in French, and the gentleman that they chose to follow stands up. Without thinking, the two Americans stand up as well. Without warning, the whole church bursts into laughter.
Realizing that no one else is standing up but the two of them and the man that they had been watching, the Americans leave, embarrassed. They wait for the mass to end and then approach the priest, who also spoke English. "We're well-meaning people, Father," one says. "We don't speak French, and we just chose some guy to imitate while praying." The priest chuckles. "Ah, you're probably wondering why everyone laughed at you then." "Yes," replied the other American. "Well, you see, I announced the baptism of a child and asked for the father of the child to stand up." And that's a story about how the family you're baptized into is bigger than you realize. That's what today's reading from Scripture is trying to remind us too. Paul's letter to the Ephesians tells us that God chose us to be a part of God's family. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will. Before we were born, before we were even conceived, God knew us, God loved us, and God yearned for each of us to be a part of God's family. We may have our own parents, just like Allie and Reed do, but God wants to be our parent too. And so my message for each of you today is to treat yourself and everyone that you meet as a beloved member of God's family. Because that's what God wants for all of us, to treat ourselves and everyone that we meet as if they are beloved members of God's family. What the act of baptism is a welcoming of someone into the Christian family. Baptism is a sign of their participation in the family of God, and the act of baptism is an outward symbol of an inward reality, something that's true whether we recognize it or not, that the one being baptized is and has been, since before they were even conceived, marked as a child of God. You're right. You're absolutely right. Jesus called the first disciples to make a family out of humanity, to welcome them, to take them in, and to teach them all of the messages of God that Jesus revealed to them in his every action, his every word. And that's what we promise to do when we baptize children. Their nuclear family, their godparents, and us as a worldwide church, we all promise to support these children, that they may grow up surrounded by God's love. In all the miles Jesus walked, he welcomed in strangers, sinners, the contagious, the hopeless, the alien, the poor. He lifted them up, fed them, healed them, showed them how to live a better, holier way, and asked them not only to follow him, but to carry God's light into the world through their very own lives. Jesus welcomed all of those people to show us just how many of us God wants to adopt. Jesus adopted us as his brothers, his sisters, his siblings, all God's children. And when we take communion on the first Sunday of every month, which we did just last week, we are recommitting to that membership in Jesus' family. Now, what our scripture reading for today doesn't do is it doesn't bother to define exactly who it is God wants as God's children or who it is God doesn't. It doesn't provide any sort of litmus test. The people God wants to adopt don't glow green under an ultraviolet light or anything like that. I mean, how could we as human beings possibly know or figure out decisions like that that God made before the foundations of the world were laid? It's not like Santa's naughty or nice list that we could try to steal from the North Pole. Now, personally, based on my studies and my faith, I believe that God fell in love with every human being that will ever be born at the beginning of time. I believe God chose all of us little children before the very foundations of the world were laid. I believe that God wants all people to be part of God's family, and every single human being is born worthy of adoption. But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe some of us are so rotten that no Daddy Warbucks would ever want to adopt us, and our all-knowing God has known we'd end up that way since before we were born. I don't want to believe that. I have no interest in believing that. But theologians have been arguing back and forth about predestination for centuries. And yet, even if I'm wrong, even if God wants some people as a part of God's family and other people don't deserve it, we have no way of knowing who those people are. We can't look at someone and know, either on their face or through their actions, good or bad, whether God wants them as God's own. Remember our reading. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. That means that even if you've messed up, even if you've done wrong, even if you're a failure or a criminal, when you have a true relationship with God, you are washed clean. Whether it's by the waters of baptism, transformation through prayer, or taking part in Holy Communion, you are recognizing and committing to your place in God's family, that you are God's beloved child. If God can do that for us, that means anyone we meet could be God's beloved child, even if they don't know it yet. Anyone. God has already marked you as beloved. God marked Allie and Reed as beloved long, long before they were baptized today. And if that's true, if God loved Allie and Reed and chose them to be a part of God's family long before they were even a twinkle in their parents' eyes, and if you can believe that God did the same to you, well, then you should live every day. You should believe and act every day like you are a beloved member of God's family. And you should treat yourself and everyone that you meet as a beloved member of God's family. In that spirit, I'll leave you with an excerpt from the 1885 poem that inspired the most famous adoptee in comics history, Little Orphan Annie. And Little Orphan Annie says, "When the blaze is blue, and the lampwick sputters, and the wind goes woo-woo, you better mind your parents and your teachers fond and dear, and cherish them that loves you, and dry the orphan's tear, and help the poor and needy ones at clusters all about, or the goblins'll get you if you don't watch out." I don't know about any goblins, but the rest of it sounds like our brother Jesus to me. Amen.
Loving Spirit, you have chosen me to be. You have drawn me to your wonder. You have set your sign on me. Like a mother, you enfold me. Hold my life within your own. Feed me with your very body. Form me of your flesh and bone.
the Father, you protect me. Teach me the discerning eye. Hoist me up upon your shoulder. Let me see the world from high. Friend and lover, in your closeness, I am known and held and blessed. In your promise is my comfort. In your presence I may rest. Loving Spirit, loving Spirit, you have chosen me to be. You have drawn me to your wonder. You have set your sign on me.
We have been given so much to celebrate in this life, not the least of which is God's love. That's where it starts. And the beauty of the faith relationship that we have with God is that when we put our faith in God, when we open our heart to God's love, we feel moved to take part in that love, to respond to that love in kind, not as a payment for services rendered, not as a down payment on a condo in heaven, but as a knee-jerk, reflexive response to the feelings that God wells up inside of us. God has given us love, and we seek to magnify that love through God's church, through all of God's children, wherever we meet them. And so this morning, as you consider what your morning offering is, whether it is an offering of money that you place in one of the boxes on your way out today, whether you drop a prayer into that offering box, physically or mentally, dropping a little prayer on your way out, whether it is some act of service that you perform for your church, for another organization in town, for someone that you know that needs it so much, may your offering this day and every day come from a place of love, not from a place of obligation. Seek what God needs and fill that need. And through so doing, may this family, children of God all, come closer and closer together every single day. In that spirit, whatever your morning offering be, we give it to God.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God all creatures here below. Praise God above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
As you go forth from this place, may God's grace shine upon you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. May you know God's love. May you feel God's love. And may you share God's love everywhere you go with everyone that you meet. For you are beloved by God, and so are they. Amen. Thank you.
Go in peace.